Professor Grossmann.
Okay, thank you very much for a kind introduction, Savi. It's a pleasure to be with you. Of course, it would be even a greater pleasure if I could be at Campinas and, you know, be in person. But, well, this is the reality we have to face. So let me show you the first slide so we can get started with the presentation. Yeah. So basically, what I'd like to talk is in general about the role of process systems engineering in chemical engineering education. And I think, you know, I was asked to emphasize maybe also, you know, issues related to computing, which I will try to do during my presentation. So first, since you might not be totally familiar with what is process systems engineering, it's really the area within chemical engineering where you're concerned with systematic analysis and optimization, and it's for decision making, and that comprises all the way from discovery of new products, design of processes, manufacturing, and distribution. So that's sort of the general, if you wish, scope of process systems engineering. And of course, an important question that arises is, what is the science base behind this? And well, on the one hand, there's of course what you might call the process knowledge that comes from chemical engineering, conceptual design, with which we can then perform process integration. Then the second one is numerical analysis, because of course simulation plays a key role to try to predict the performance of processes and products. Then mathematical programming, which is a term we now use for optimization, is the one that we use to synthesize, design, and, you know, optimize in general process systems. Then systems and control theory is, of course, the other major area that deals especially, of course, with process control that plays a key aspect in manufacturing. Then computer science, of course, that's also, you know, part of the science base, and these days, of course, has to do with parts of artificial intelligence, advanced computing, at the end with a goal of more efficient problem solving. But then also management science is also another important component of process systems engineering. Why? Because, of course, at the end, we're dealing with things like supply chains, and we also need to understand sort of the basic business drivers that are behind this. Okay, so this is just to give you a general review of what this process is in engineering. And if at any point, by the way, there's a question or you want to interrupt me, please feel free to do so. Okay? Now, so what are then the major areas in process systems engineering? Well, one is design, how we integrate, how we put together process flow sheets. That's one extreme. The other one is process control, making sure that, you know, we have a, you know, equipment or a process that, you know, is performing within, you know, some desired targets, some limits, and then operations. Operations these days, I think chemical engineers are becoming increasingly also involved in supply chains, like the one that I'm showing in the figure that I have here. Okay, now, and one of the key problems in these areas is synthesis. How do we put together the process flow sheet? Which variables do we measure? Which variables do we control? And in a supply chain, you know, what are for example, the plants, how do we integrate them with distribution centers to finally deliver the product to the customers? Okay, now, so I thought that after this introduction, to give the overall perspective, since I know you're interested in education, to tell you a little bit about the curriculum in chemical engineering at Carnegie Mellon. So here I'm showing all the courses, and as you can see, the introductory courses, we have two courses on physics, and we have a number of courses of chemistry lab, biochemistry that has not been introduced, and physical chemistry. So these are taught by departments outside from chemical engineering. Then on the math side, we have calculus 1, 2, and 3. That's differential, integral, and multivariable. And then we teach our own KME math, because we found over the years that we had to tailor the math to our students. So one issue that we do face at Carnegie Mellon and also overall in the US is that, for example, these days a lot of the students come with advanced placement. In other words, calculus 1 and 2, they take at the high school. That means that for all practical purposes, they're only taking two math courses in the 4 years, Calc 3 and the KME math. It's something that I've been trying to change, but well, it's very difficult to make them more courses. But we'll see that there's one at least, I'm sorry, promising development. So then the mainstream courses in chemical engineering, introductory course, we have an interesting thing that the first semester, first year at Carnegie Mellon is common for all engineers. So they can pick chemical, mechanical, civil. They have to do take two, and they select one of them. So this is basically the mass, basic mass energy balances. Then we have a basic course on thermodynamics first, you know, second law, and then chemi-thermo, which is basically phase equilibrium, reaction equilibrium. And then what we have from here, our basic transport courses, fluid mechanics, heat and mass transfer. Then this is the course in unit operations at the same time from thermo then to reaction engineering. And what happens here at the end is a lot of these courses then converge to the course of process design, which is a course I'd like to focus a little bit more because we do rely on knowledge of all the previous courses and tools. And then we do have something unique at Carnegie Mellon. We do have a mini course on optimization. This is not common in most of the department. We do that at Carnegie Mellon because we have a big effort in the area. And we also teach a course called product design, which is also kind of one of the new trends, teaching not only about process, but also about product design. And then we have, of course, here also the course on process control. So this is basically the general curriculum that we have at Carnegie Mellon. And I know you're interested in computational tools. So what do our students use throughout their curriculum? Well, obviously, at the simplest level, Excel, you know, all the way from the first course to even the design course to preliminary calculations. MATLAB is the other major platform. Again, we do introduce students in the intro to chemi course in MATLAB. MATLAB, they tend to revisit, especially in the course of process control because of the linear algebra. Fluid mechanics, we make use of a package called Fluent, you know, to do some of the more detailed calculation, Navier-Stokes equation type of calculation. And then for the design course, the major workhorse is Aspen Plus. It's a process simulator. And then basically we also, in the optimization course, use a modeling system called GAMP. So we do try to make our students make use. So I do have to admit, we still are not at the stage, in my opinion, where we have been successful in integrating computing throughout the curriculum. For example, in my opinion, the process simulator Aspen, and I have taught thermodynamics before, is a perfect tool for thermodynamics. It's for the second course where you have equations of state, the liquid activity coefficients, and so forth, complex calculations, flash calculations. The course of unit operations is, for example, another course where this can be used. So far, unfortunately, it's not happened. It's only used at the level of process design. Okay, so this is what we do at Carnegie Mellon. And I thought it might be interesting for you also to learn a little bit about what some of the other schools do. I mean, Minnesota, you know, has, of course, a very, you know, strong reputation in chemical engineering. You notice they have added, for example, biology. Now, that's one of their basic courses. But it's interesting in terms of their math. They have, you know, of course, the calculus 1-2, multivariable, linear algebra. And then one of the things that is also unique about Minnesota, a very nice course on computational methods. Actually, Professor Dautides has a very nice textbook on that. And I would say they're definitely, you know, in a very good position. They've also introduced a course on product design by Professor Ed Kostler. In the case of Princeton, for example, it's been kind of a somewhat radical type of change that they made there, in the sense that there's only 7 chemical engineering required courses. So basically, material energy, thermodynamics, then they do transport in one single semester, reactors and separations, design, and then the lab. The idea is that students can have many options, you know, for doing courses, but again, it has been at the expense of consolidating courses like transport, fluid, heat, and mass is one single semester. Thermodynamics is also one single semester. On the other hand, math, you know, it's for U.S. standards, it's a good, they have calculus 1 and 2. Then they have multivariable, they have linear algebra, okay, and then differential equations. So this is a good thing, because one of the problems we do have in the States is the math education is not in very good shape. And according to the international standards, the U.S. is ranked number 38 in math at the high school level. So we're not starting with a very good level. It's different. Science is like 14 and reading is 11. So it's much better in those stages. But the reason I mentioned mathematics is because, in my humble opinion, that's something that we do need to reinforce if we want to especially have our students to become proficient in computation. So let me now turn the question. Since I'm teaching a course on process design, I want to give you just sort of a general overview of course. And of course, it's basically about conceiving a design system. And the question is, you know, how does a design course that we teach over differ from previous courses? So I think one of the things that students tend to have a little bit more difficulty is the idea of decision making. In other words, it's no longer the issue where you say, here's a problem, give me an answer. But rather, the students all of a sudden have to make a decision, which processes do we select? For example, synthesis strategies. You know, we're given a problem, we want to produce this product. Now you need to decide what are the alternative technologies. Go and look at the literature and find out. The other thing that is also an issue in the design course that takes a little bit of, for the students to overcome is this idea of being able to do simplified analysis. You know, to become more of an engineer, somebody who can estimate, make looks at the numbers, do they make sense or not? And that's something that, again, we don't really teach throughout the curriculum, and it's mostly in the design course where that hits well. And the other one is, of course, also what I would call try to learn to make, quote, what I would call educated guesses. So, for example, they may go to the literature, find out, you know, about some process flow sheet, and some information might not be complete. Well, if they don't have the information, they may have to, you know, come up at least with some what I would call educated guesses, you know, something that makes sense. And again, these are more, if you wish, qualitative type of considerations, but nevertheless, I do think they are important for an engineering education. And then the other one is, again, how do you screen alternatives? So one of the things, as you'll see, that we emphasize in design course, we don't give them a process and tell them do the heat mass balance and do the sizing, because that's a well-defined problem. No, we want to ask them, you know, go out to the literature, pick a flow sheet, you make a decision, and then, you know, it's that type of approach that we're taking. So the other thing is, of course, you know, our course does have more industrial relevance, because in a way it could be thought as being more practical. This is just like one example of a project this we did in 2015. It was producing fuel-grade ethanol from ethylene. So again, you know, students had to come up, go to the literature. And what I'm showing here is basically the Aspen simulation of one of the designs that the students proposed for that system. Then this is another example of a project. This was a year later, going from ethane to ethylene. One of the things you have to understand, here in Pennsylvania, we're in the midst of the revolution of the shale gas. That shale has a, you know, large percentage of liquid natural gases, especially ethane. Actually, Shell is building a new plant here to produce ethylene. So we ask the students here to say, well, one alternative could be steam cracking. So they have to, you know, again, come up and design and synthesize the flow sheet. So this is one of the flow sheets they proposed. But they also were given the option of saying, well, there's other technologies. So what happens if you do, for example, partial oxidation? Are there some, what are the trade-offs? What is the economics? So that's the type of projects that we tend to do. And I've been very, very fortunate to have Professor Jeff Cirola. He's at Purdue University, who's helped me, you know, to come up with these projects. We do give only one project for the entire class, because again, we want them to analyze different alternatives, and at the end they will report what is the design and alternative that they are actually proposing. Okay, now given that background, of course, the teaching of design has been changing over the years. In the past, for example, it was regarded as more something like based on experience. And now these days, what's also happening here in the States, this area of process design, because there's been this strong bent towards science. So many professors do not want to teach this course. So when they don't have professors to teach this course, they have to resort, for example, to a retired engineer. And here I'm just showing some of the classical textbooks on processes of science, Peter Simmerhaus, Ludwig, Basil. But again, these are very old textbooks, and of course the science has changed a lot since then. The modern approaches are focusing more on the big picture, what I told you before. What is a flow sheet? How do you put it together? And also we talk about things like what's the environmental impact, life cycle analysis, and so forth. And the other important thing is we want to convey the idea that there are systematic approaches. This is not just simply and purely an intuitive exercise. We do emphasize synthesis, and we also, explore the use of a computer in the course here, especially at the end. Students have to do, an Aspen simulation of the flow sheet, like the ones I presented before. Now, just for a brief word about textbooks on what are called modern design approaches. So here, one of the pioneering books came from the University of Wisconsin. Professor Dale Roth had this book on strategy for process engineering. It was late 60s, but it was truly pioneering in the sense for the first time said, well, we ought to be able to approach these problems in a systematic manner. And then the next step was this also very nice book by Dale Roth and Cirola called Process Synthesis, where the idea was precisely to convey the point that, how do you integrate process approaches rather than taking the attitude, here's a given, now analyze it. No, what's the structure of the flow sheet that we want to put together? Then this is work by Art Westbury, my colleague retired here at Carnegie Mellon. Process flow sheeting, that sort of gave the basis for process simulation. Then Bodo Lindhoff, I don't know if you know the name, but he was in the UK, the University of Leeds, and joined ICI later on, UMIS, which is now University of Manchester, wrote this nice book on Guide of Process Integration, again giving a more systematic approach on how to address these problems. Jim Douglas has been also another contributor, his book on conceptual design of processes, again emphasizing hierarchical decomposition, emphasizing synthesizing flow sheets. Then here at Carnegie Mellon with my colleague Larry Beagle, Art Westberg, we've written a book called Systematic Methods for Chemical Process Design. This was in 96. We're currently actually with Professor Xi Zhang from Minnesota, writing the second edition of that book. Then Robin Smith is another example, University of Manchester. And again, the idea is the emphasis on integration. Again, more effective use of energy, water, and so forth. And then a more recent book is the one by Warren Cedar with Daniel Lewin and Bob Cedar, University of Utah, where for the first time they introduced in the course not only process but also product design. And I have to say, there's still a little bit of a debate whether it's a good idea to do this in a single course or whether it's better to leave product design as a separate course, which is, for example, what we do at Carnegie Mellon. And then another recent example is this book by Gavin Towler. Again, he's from BOP. That's more of a practical design book for doing costing estimation. Okay, so the main thing here that I want to convey that what we want to do and teach our students is this concept of process synthesis, how you generate systematically alternatives for process flow sheets. And the generic problem is as follows: to say, well, given some inputs, for example, some raw material that I have available, given some outputs, that's maybe a given product we want to produce, what we want to ask is, how do we convert the raw materials into the products? What phenomena can we exploit? What is the kind of equipment that we can use for that? How do we interconnect that? And it turns out, and people have shown that, when you do view the problem like this, it's not, two, three alternatives. It usually can generate hundreds, sometimes thousands of different alternatives. And that's what we want to convey to our students about the importance of synthesizing, because that's where you can have the biggest impact for example, on the economics, impact on environmental issues, and so forth. Okay, now process synthesis is an area that on the one hand has concentrated first on subsystems. So there's a lot of literature on heat exchanger network synthesis, separation synthesis, reactor networks, steam and power plants. So these are specific sub-problems, subsystems, and I'll show you very briefly some of the developments in those areas. And the basic idea here is what has made a big difference is using some representations that can help to better synthesize each one of these subsystems. And then when we look at the total process flow sheet, then what we're talking about here are some basic methodologies that I'll describe very briefly. But be aware, in synthesis, when we teach, we do teach subsystems, especially heat exchange and network separations, but then we also teach them overall process flow sheets. Okay, now this is just one example. I don't know if you're familiar with the concept of pinch analysis, but what was very nice there was to say, given a process, what is the minimum heating and cooling that is required? And what Linhoff did with was actually at home and also before University of California, the idea that all the streams in a process could be joined as a single composite hot in a single composite cold. And then the idea here is that you would place these curves as close as possible within a given temperature approach, HRAT, a heat recovery approach temperature of 20 degrees. And with that approach, you could then predict ahead of the network what is the minimum heating and what's the minimum cooling. This is very significant, you see, because this is not first law. First law would be just a simple heat balance, but here, this is like a second law type of analysis because you're taking into account the feasibility of the heat exchange. And the idea here is that before you even worry about what exactly should be the structure of the network, you have now some targets that tell you, you know, what should be the minimum heating, what should be the minimum cooling. Another example of the representation is in the area of isotropic distillation, work by Mike Doherty with John Perkins. The idea here is you have, say, those three components, and the idea is that you have this boundary that tells you, you know, that it's impossible to go beyond, for example, this distillation boundary here. And that then means when you generate your alternatives, there are some alternatives that you can actually exclude because you cannot reach, for example, from this point to the boundary here. Okay, this is again just an example for representation. Another one, Professor Ben Glasser, South Africa, together with Dan Hildebrand, have been very instrumental in the idea of attainable regions. So basically, the plot here, concentration of the product, concentration of the reactant, and then give you sort of the, what is the configuration between a PFR and a CSTR as you move in the concentration space. They call this attainable region. And again, but you can see the main point here is to use some representations that somehow help you to simplify all the issue of the alternatives. Okay, so here again, the PFR and CSTR. So when we look then at process flow sheets, how do we actually do the search? So one is the representation. How do we now do the search? First, Stephanopoulos and Westberg came up with this idea of evolutionary search. You start from the alternatives and then you keep, you know, adding or deleting. That's sort of an evolution. That's why it's called evolutionary. Then the next step was systematic generation. What is interesting here, the work by Cirola and Powers, which was based on mean scent analysis, this actually came from artificial intelligence. It was actually Professor Herb Simon here at Carnegie Mellon, who was involved with problem solving for AI. And that's what they were using. They generated a computer program called ACE that would systematically generate process flow sheets. The other approach is hierarchical decomposition, which again is used also especially like in electrical engineering. But then the other approach, which is the one we've been working on for many years, is what we call superstructure optimization. So we'd like to think that we can formulate a problem ultimately as a superstructure that has embedded many alternatives, in which either we end up with NLP, means nonlinear programming, MINLP, mixed integer nonlinear programming. There's something called disjunctive programming. The details don't matter except to know these are mathematical optimization models so that if you optimize them, then you can extract from the superstructure the best alternative. Now, let me talk briefly before that, though, about hierarchical decomposition. That's the approach I mentioned, conceptual design. And the idea here, what Jim Douglas did, and this actually we do teach, because I think this is very teachable in the design course at the beginning, especially to tell them, look, you know, you systematically take a problem, you design, should you go about your continuous, that you should based on the amount, then you look at the input-output level, just an overall analysis. Do the economics even make sense? If they don't make sense, just reject it and look at some other alternative. And once you go through the input-output level, you go to the recycle, look here mostly at the reactor without worrying about separation and heat integration. And once you decide on the reactor, you then do the separation and lastly the heat recovery. So this is type of thinking, at least initially, we have found, it's very good for students, because then at least they learn to take a flow, to take a problem and go systematically through these steps to come up with an alternative. And we also show them the inverse, take a flow sheet and go backwards, so to go through these steps to see what are the various levels. So I would highly recommend this, especially for the beginning part of the course. But then I mentioned before, we are in what we call mathematical programming. This means optimization. We have here continuous variable X, discrete variables are usually 0, 1, whether or not you select a given piece of equipment. We minimize, for example, a given cost function, function of X and Y. Equations here are normally heat, mass balances, inequalities are specifications. And basically here, this is a more general problem, but there are special types of problems. If everything is linear, this is called mixed integer linear programming. If there's no discrete variables, it's linear programming. If there's non-linearities but no discrete, it's called NLP. So we do this actually, we don't teach as part of the design course, but rather after the design course, as I'll discuss later, we have a course in optimization where we do teach students about these type of tools, okay? And what's interesting here to notice is, because maybe this is not always well known, but chemical engineers in process systems have contributed, you know, quite extensively to theory and algorithms for these optimization problems, nonlinear, mixed integer, and global optimization. So if you look at number of the papers, they're published in journals like Mathematical Programming, Journal of Global Optimization, because the PSC community has been very active in these areas. Okay, now, so what's the approach based on mathematical programming for process synthesis? The sort of three basic steps. The first one is to develop a superstructure of alternatives. Once we do that, then we do develop a model to, you know, select the topology and corresponding parameters like operating conditions, and then we solve that problem either depending on the nature, if it's nonlinear, disjunctive, or to extract from the superstructure the best design. That's kind of the basic philosophy. I have to say, we teach this approach, for example, I'm teaching right now a graduate course on process systems engineering, and this is precisely the material that we cover. In the book that I told you about, Beigler, Westberg, and me, the parts 3 and 4 are all about how you apply this approach to process synthesis problems. So what are some of the challenges that we have here? Well, obviously, postulating a superstructure, you need to have knowledge of the system, and that's why we ask students first to do an extensive literature survey, including patents, so they understand what is available. Then the second part that becomes, of course, here very important is model formulation. I would argue that modeling is a key skill that our students need to learn. You know, how do we write down the equations? This is supported, of course, by previous courses in transport phenomena, thermodynamics. So in that sense, it's kind of a nice extension. But the part that is not always easy for them is capturing the logic through constraints. And then, you know, try to select an appropriate algorithm depending on the particular feature of the problem. And I thought I'd just give you maybe here just like one example of a problem. This is the transshipment model for heat integration. What it is here, we have 4 hot streams, 2 cold streams. And the idea here, heat is like a commodity that is transferred from the hot to the cold, but going through these intermediate, if you wish, warehouses, where we ensure that there is feasible heat exchange. The details don't matter here, except just to say, again, the importance of a representation. We want to, at the end, minimize the cost of fuel that we need here, this gets dumped here into the cooling water. We may have high pressure steam, low pressure steam, intermediate utilities. So this problem, what we have, these are then the unknown variables, the heat loads, okay? And then also the heat residual, how much flows from one level to the other, because it's, flowing from high to low temperature. And then basically this problem, what we do, we model as a linear programming problem. And the concept is actually fairly simple. At each interval or each warehouse, as I showed before in the previous slide, each one of these we call the temperatures are selected so that you ensure feasible heat transfer. And then once you have that particular interval, it's again pretty straightforward to just write down a heat balance, which is basically this equation here in terms of the outlet residual, inlet residuals, and the various amounts of heat. And these are the amounts of heat that are supplied by a hot stream, amounts of heat that are required by the cold stream. That's the right hand side. This is a linear programming problem. So we do teach actually this LP transshipment model. So what we do in the course, when we teach a design course, we give them a tool where this method has been implemented, but then after the course, they learn how to do this. Okay, so we first want them, again, to concentrate more on the conceptual side. And then when we have the optimization course, then we go and emphasize, you know, how you actually model these problems. And this is just like a simple example to hot streams, to cold streams. And based on the data, you can then, formulate the problem. This would be the particular model for those stream data that I showed to you. This is a linear programming problem, okay? And then, this is the answer that you get. This is the graphically before, if you remember, at 60 kilowatts of heating, 225 for cooling. That's exactly what you get from the LP. By the way, talking about linear programming, just a small transgression here. It turns out one of the first applications of linear programming was in the petroleum industry. And interestingly enough, that place actually here in Pittsburgh. Not too far from Pittsburgh, there's a place called Oil City. That's where the initial development of oil took place. There was a company called Gulf Oil. Gulf Oil has now been absorbed recently by Chevron. But basically what they did at the time, we were talking maybe late 40s, early 50s, Charles and Cooper, professors from Carnegie Mellon, applied linear programming to the planning of production refinery. So actually, in that sense, if you think about it, optimization has been, from the very beginning, always very much involved in the petrochemical industry. Okay, now let me give you an example. So first, the transshipment mode is just to target how much heating and cooling. But now let's assume you want to know what is the actual structure of the network. This is what we call the superstructure. So I have here hot stream one, hot stream two, cold stream one, cold stream two. And what we're doing simply is a sequence of stages, and each stage we consider all possible exchanges. So H1 can exchange with C1, with C2, then we mix them, then again with C1, C2, and likewise for each one of the other streams. Now the key variable here is a 0-1 variable. Zijk is going to be equal to 1 if a hot I exchanges heat with a cold stream J, and it's 0 if they do not. Okay. Now, of course, I'm not going to give you here the details of the model. We actually have it implemented in a on the web. It's Unichemy interfaces. So students actually they learn the concept, but we don't make them program it, so because that's a fair amount of work, but at least they need to understand what are the basic assumptions that we have behind this this model. Okay, and here again, this is, for example, the solution that we obtained. This is called the grid diagram. Tells you for hot stream 1, 2, C1 and C2, for example, there's an exchange between H1 and C1, 90 kilowatts, and these are the corresponding temperature, the area is 11 square meter, and so forth. So this is just a convenient representation for heat exchangers, and it's actually used these days by commercial products. Like Aspen Energy Analysis uses precisely this type of representation. It uses also the type of optimization that I've just described before. Now, and then what you can also get for once you get the network, you can plot the curves that just simply reassure you how tightly integrated the system is. You can see here, this is a composite hot, composite cold. So you can see that almost throughout all the heat from the hot stream is being transferred to the cold stream. So that means it's a good indication. So because we also feel it's nice to give this physical view, it's not simply trust the mathematics that, you know, we get somehow the optimum, but we would like to see, does it make some physical sense? And that's basically what we do then here. Now, so let me talk briefly then. So I describe what we do in the design course. So if you remember from that initial diagram that I presented, we have a course on optimization modeling and algorithms. This is taught right after the design course. And it's, we call this a 6-unit course. It's a mini course. It's half of a semester. And again, the basic emphasis here is solution of mathematical optimization problems, you know, with discrete and continuous variables, like what I presented. But we find that it's actually very useful once the students have gone through the design experience. They have now much better feel for degrees of freedom and so forth. And then, you know, it's also like in the design project, we don't want them to get bogged down with the details. But here, once they go through the experience, now they learn how you do this systematically. So we have that course. And another course is, of course, chemical process control. That's taught in the senior year. And here again, as I mentioned before, the basic tool that is used here is especially MATLAB, because linear algebra plays a major role for chemical process control. And then we remember I told you about the course on chemical product design. This is the one after we teach process optimization, we teach the product design course. There's still a little bit of controversy in this course in the following sense. Chemical process design is only done by chemical engineers. There's no other discipline. But product design is actually done by mechanical engineers, by design people, by chemists, and so forth. So we need to be aware. The reason I mention this is that there are some schools that are starting to say, well, maybe we should only teach product design because it's more important than process. In my opinion, that would be a huge mistake, because chemical engineering is largely based upon processes. That's what makes us different. And yes, it's good that we also learn about product design, but not at the expense of eliminating, for example, process design. Now, a new course. So finally, after, you know, the various experiences that we've had, we said, well, we need to somehow integrate our courses. And one of the things that we found is a course on numerical methods. Interestingly enough, many years ago, Professor Biegler and I were teaching such a course. But the trend has been, as in many universities, tried to consolidate, reduce the number of courses, they actually did away with a course on numerical methods. And just to give you this anecdote, which I'm a little bit embarrassed to tell you, but I have to tell you, last semester when I was teaching the design course, you know, we had to solve one equation in one unknown, one nonlinear equation in one unknown. And I told to the class, do you know how to solve this problem? Well, some of them said, well, maybe you use Excel or something like that. I told them, well, no, I mean, you use Newton's method. Anybody knows about Newton's method? I was shocked. Nobody knew about Newton's method. I think that's a total disgrace. And that's not what we're trying to remedy, because this is just simply not acceptable to have students who, you know, don't have also, you know, at least some basic knowledge on numerical methods. But one interesting thing here that's happening is that this course is now also going to be combined with some basic knowledge on machine learning. Of course, as you know, there's a lot of hype these days about machine learning. So what we're going to do in this course is, you know, teach still the basics in terms of solving ordinary differential equations, systems of nonlinear equations, so together with, of course, linear equations by all means. This would be the more traditional numerical methods. And then machine learning, if you really look at what machine learning is, basically statistics of linear, nonlinear regression. That's what it is, basically, polynomial fitting, Gaussian processes. So it's important, of course, that our students, you know, do become aware of that. So this is a course that we're going to start teaching as of next year to remedy the hole that we have found, if you wish, in our curriculum at Carnegie Mellon. So we'll I'd be happy to share with you our experiences when we teach that course. So just to finish very briefly, since I talk mostly about education, just wanted to mention also very briefly about the year itself of process systems engineering, just to give you an idea. So one of the things that's happened, it's greatly expanded its scope. Usually it's been concentrated here in the middle, process units, plants, just as we've done in the design course. But then, of course, there's also been the move towards, you know, molecular level, you know, the picometer, the nanosecond type of scale, or the other, and then at the same time also at the other extreme, at the enterprise level. So we actually have, for example, in our Center for Advanced Process Decision Making, a program called Enterprise-Wide Optimization. It is largely about supply chains. Okay, so that's some of the trends that are happening in the area. And we can even think, of course, also at the global level, especially with emphasis these days on climate change. Now, so what are some of the challenges in process systems? Well, you find them product process design, energy sustainability. I think energy sustainability is clearly emerging as a major, major challenge that we need to address. Now, especially I think with the pandemic, that has made it even more evident about the need for that. And then what I called before as enterprise-wide optimization. I just want to give you a very quick, very superficial view of what some of the things that are happening in this area. Here, this is a slide from Professor Joseph Lopoulos, where, you know, we go at the level of design from flow sheets like the ones that I showed you before to microprocessing like plant on a chip, and then at the molecular level, at the cell level, and view that as a reactor. The idea of multi-scale modeling is actually kind of an important concept that our students also need to learn. And here's a specific example of a design of a process using, again, the concept of superstructure. This is work I've done with Mariano Martín, Salamanca in Spain. The idea here is that you take switchgrass, you know, and you have alternatives for gasification, for reforming, cleanup, then here the adjustment, water gas shift reaction, pressure swing absorption. Here again, you remove sour gases, again, different alternatives. And then the two major routes, fermentation route, which is more the biological route, or the Fischer-Tropsch, the catalytic route. So this is what we call a superstructure. And the idea then is to model, to pick out from here what would be hopefully the best flow sheet. And here, this is what we get in solving the optimization problem. It tells us we want to do direct gasification, then followed by steam reforming. Then we have actually pressure swing absorption, where we obtain hydrogen. Then we do the removal of CO2 with monoethanolamine. And then it selects the catalytic route. So this would come out from solving an optimization problem from all the alternatives that we had embedded in the previous slide from here. If you count the number of alternatives, might be maybe something of the order of 100 or so different flow sheet that you could actually generate. Okay, here what was interesting, what came out is this is the economics of the process, but what was interesting was the fact that since we're separating hydrogen, the cost of ethanol, if you account for the credit of producing hydrogen that you can sell, you can reduce the net price from 81 cents per gallon to 41 cents per gallon. Okay, so sort of like an extra important credit that could make, because you see, one of the problems with these bio type of processes is that, you know, they're expensive. So economically, it's challenging to make them viable. Now, then here, being in Pennsylvania, we're in the midst of the shale gas revolution. You might have heard about it. What you do, drilling and you get here at the level of the rock. You inject water at very high pressure. And what is expected here, at least in the United States, a good part of the production of natural gas, maybe more than half, will come actually from shale gas. And that's what's happening these days. And here I'm showing the map of Pennsylvania. This is the state of Pennsylvania. We're right here in this corner. Pittsburgh is right here. So you can see we're right in the midst. All these dots represent developments for shale gas. And Professor Jeff Cirola has written a very nice article in the AICHG journal on what are the implications of shale gas also for the chemical industry. Here we see it almost right away. Shale is building a huge new plant for producing ethylene, you know, based on the ethane that comes out from the shale gas. And I just want to show you here again very briefly one example of a project we did with a company called EQT to do the planning of shale gas production. What you have here in the squares, these are potential sites where you can do drilling. In each site, you can drill these days up to 20 different wells. Okay, in that sense, you then minimize also the effect of the footprint on the environment. And the idea then here is to find, you know, how do you interconnect these well paths with the pipelines? Where do you need a plant for natural gas to separate the methane? Then you also need, for example, to supply water. Okay, for the fracturing. Again, we're very quick about the infrastructure design. And then we also have also the big problem, how do you predict the production? So here we're using, of course, some special models that have been developed, but the challenge is that you get with shale gas very rapid decline. We write this problem as a mixed integer nonlinear optimization problem. I'm not going to describe it in detail, but just to give you an idea, discrete variables to decide how many wells do you drill, continuous variables, and with nonlinear objective function. It's a non-convex MINLP. It's challenging to solve, but we develop a special method for that. And here, this is what we obtain from the model. It tells us, again, it's the same philosophy, superstructure optimization. It tells us which pipelines to install, what is the diameter. Here you have your plants of natural gas. You're separating here the ethane, here the methane. This goes to the gathering pipeline. And this is the net present value. But what is also interesting about the solution of this problem, this is the took about 8.5 hours to solve this problem, is not only that you're getting the structure of the infrastructure, but also the drilling plan. What I'm plotting here, these are quarters, T1, T2, 3 month time period. And for each of the well paths, we're indicating how many wells are you drilling. And you can see initially there's a fairly active area of drilling. This one decreases because of shortage of water, because it's summer, okay? But then it starts to decrease. And the reason for that is an interesting challenge in this problem is to try to track the production so that you reach some maximum, like here in the case of methane, and here in the case of ethane, you're used to the maximum extent possible the capacity. So again, this is something you could do with optimization. Enterprise-wide optimization, as I mentioned before, this is kind of an emerging area. It arises on the one hand in the oil industry. I mean, you have in Brazil, of course, companies like Petrobras, who are in the business, starting from a well pass where you extract the oil, you transfer, you take it to the refinery, and then ultimately one of the products, like gasoline, gets delivered to the level of the pump. But then this idea also applies to other industries, like pharmaceutical industry. Pharmaceutical industry, you do the discovery of your molecules, then you do preclinical and three-phase clinical trials, okay, and then if it passes all those tests, then it launches to the market. And this can be a very long, very extensive, expensive procedure, takes 10, 20 years. What I find very fascinating these days with the development of some of the vaccines, that time has actually been shrunk tremendously. Of course, they did start already with some known molecules that they knew that they would work. But again, the idea here is how you plan this is, again, still part of its logistics, if you wish. And this then takes us also looking a little bit into the future. I think we also need to convey to our students some of the future trends, like the famous industry 4.0, having cyber-physical systems, the Internet of Things, the challenges that come with that. How can we exploit computing for that? And here I have this slide I'd like to show. It's actually from Monsanto. It's what they call the digital supply chain. And what it is here on the right, these are the phases going from product development in the lab, manufacturing, then warehousing, distribution, and sales. So you integrate all the functions in the company that you have here. And on the left, you start here with the data foundation. So here you have the part of the analytics. And what's interesting in the, what's interesting in the analytics, you see two major drivers. Optimization together with machine learning. Because once you have that, then you can gather the data and integrate them throughout. So that's kind of the vision these days that people are talking about, digital supply chain. Actually, in some companies, they even have created the position of chief digital officer, which I kind of find it interesting. But it's definitely one of the trends that's coming into the future. Okay, so with this, I'd like to thank, I'd like to close my talk by making some general remarks. But hopefully, I know what I presented here was a lot of material based especially on what we teach and design, but then also emphasizing some of the issues related to computing throughout the curriculum. And I think what we always need to remember when we make changes is that we still need to emphasize fundamentals. We have advisory boards, people from industry that tells us that this is what gives you the basis for lifelong learning. We should not sacrifice, if you wish, the basic fundamentals. Having said that, we do need to modernize the curriculum and add also flexibility. So for example, increasing exposure to molecular level. Okay, that's what we're doing, for example, some of our thermodynamic courses. Then energy sustainability. Those are huge issues that are emerging. And also, you know, making students aware of other sources like renewables and sustainability. You know, how to do assessment life cycle, for example. The other thing that is very important is expose students to new process technology. Okay, and also to computer science. I think one of the things, if you look at our unit operations books, they still use a lot of the units that have been used for forever, but there's actually new equipment that we don't tell our students about that I think they should be made aware of. And computer science, again, is becoming very important these days. Here at Carnegie Mellon, fortunately, we have a very strong program. As I indicated, I think it's a good idea to introduce product design as a complement of process design, not as a substitution, but as a follow-up. Then there's this big challenge. How do you integrate curriculum throughout the curriculum? In my opinion, one of the things I would like to see is, for example, Aspen Simulator integrated, you know, maybe even from intro to do some mass balances. Thermodynamics, because that's where its strength lies. Unit operations, you can do complex distillation columns as a complement to the classical McCabe-Thiele diagram. And then in the design course, of course, plays a major role. Another important thing that we should emphasize to our students is the concept of process operations, going beyond process control and also thinking about supply chains the way I indicated before, and also making them aware of other sectors like pharma, electronics. Our students these days get jobs not only in the traditional chemical and petroleum companies, but for example, pharma companies like Merck, Eli Lilly, hiring a good companies on electronics because of the capabilities for manufacturing. And then I did not mention here much about the what I call the bio area, because of course that's here in the United States been also an area that's been increasing a lot. And I think it's obviously an important area, but you need to keep it balanced with the other areas, not to go all the way and say I'm going to throw away. Well, we always face, of course, a problem. There's only so much you can do in the curriculum, right? I mean, we can keep adding courses, but we're not going to allow to do that. So we have to be very strategic on how to do that. Then again, as I mentioned, the idea of multi-scale research going from molecular microprocess all the way to supply chain and global level. I think the students, it's very important for them to get that kind of view. And then one other very important aspect I want to mention here, close interaction with industry. I think in that sense, the design course is great. What we do when they finish their course, our students give presentations and they're attended by a good number of people from industry. And actually, some of the problems that we do in a number of cases have actually been suggested also by people from industry. The course in product design has also been a nice link with people from industry who come and talk to the students about developing new products. So I think that's really important, because otherwise we run the risk of becoming irrelevant. And just to finish off, maybe the one last major point here, I think regardless of exactly what we need, we still need to provide, you know, excitement, you know, to our students, because we want to recruit, you know, the very best young people. And I think over the years we've been successful in recruiting really good students, but, you know, competition on computing, electrical engineering, and so forth is also becoming much stiffer, even mechanical engineering. So we need to make sure we can still attract, hopefully, the best students. Okay. So with this, I'd like to thank very much your attention, and I would be very happy to answer any questions. Okay. Maybe I'll stop sharing here so you can see me.
Ignacio, thank you very much for putting together such a lovely presentation, and most of all to share with us. It was really interesting and give you a very good idea how multidisciplinary the chemical engineering field is. Before we move down to the questions, I just want you to know that Maria Teresa dropped me a line, and she asked to let you know that she has very good memories.
I see.
The time in Pittsburgh with her little ones as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Maybe let me see if I get some questions from the YouTube. If not yet, maybe I can start things warm up. I have one question for you, which is pretty much related with this interaction that it's needed with the industry and goes in line also with the first part of your presentation. And the question goes like this. When we are teaching, most of the problems, they are very well defined. Give the students a particular question, a particular information, and they need to come up with some particular answer. But it turns out that in the industry, the problems, they come up something like this. It might well be that some sort of operator comes to you and say, you know, doc, I've been working in this company for 20 years, and I never seen that yellow smoke from the chimney. So what's going on? So that's more like the problems come. So I want to hear from you how in the university you manage to migrate from their very simple academic way of putting together problem to the real world problems where the questions, they come like this yellow smoke.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I would say, as I indicated before, I still think we do need, of course, to, you know, emphasize the fundamentals. In that sense, there's nothing wrong with, you know, having still emphasizing that part, at least initially. Now, I think where the input from industry can come in is like in various forms. One of them, the design course is a very good course because it's, again, more practical in nature. And for example, here, I mean, we have a Bayer who now, or Bayer, and they changed the name to Covestro for the chemical side. They told us, I mean, we would like to know, we have all the shale gas. How can we produce aromatic? Is that something that can be done? And that was actually a project that we had one semester, which was great. And actually, the students also get very motivated because then they see we have people coming from industry who are interested in that problem. They're interested in what they're going to be doing. So I think in that sense, that's like one course, but that can be accomplished easily. Okay. Now, then there's, I would say, two other mechanisms. One of them, which I did not really mention here, is internships. So we have two major related programs there, which are the following. We do encourage our students to do summer internships. So they go and work for a company, and then, you know, they get a little bit more of that practical feel, okay? But the one sort of extreme case that we've taken there is a special program, and it's called PISIS. And basically, the idea is after the students complete their the third year, okay, they go and spend in industry one full year, and then they come back to the university. It's not too many students who do that, but the ones who do that, it's really great. This works really nice because these students, first of all, when they come back, become much more mature, right? Secondly, as you say, they've been exposed to all these industrial type of problems. And so I would say, ideally, that would be a nice thing to do. But of course, that can only be done, I would say, in relatively few cases. For the companies, it's actually also a very good thing because in that way, they get to see, you know, somebody, you know, for the entire year. And of course, in most of the cases, if they work out well, it's an ideal, you know, person that they would like to hire. So it's a win-win type of situation. But since that is not usually what we can do, I would say summer internships are still, you know, a good mechanism. And then finally, I would say the other thing that we do, which I also did not mention, when I presented the curriculum thing, there's two special seminar courses that we teach. We teach a course in the second year and a course in the third year, which is we meet 1 hour per week, and the course, the topic of the course is basically if I could call it, anything that we cannot teach in the normal courses. What do we do there? Actually, a very important component there. We do bring alumni, we bring people from industry to tell our students what are the problems they're facing. So we've had, for example, every year, some very nice speaker from Procter & Gamble always tells the students, look, you know, this is a market in China, and the market here in the U.S. is very different. So when you develop products, you have to, you know, so students, they get at least some of that feel. So we have found that that's a very nice mechanism to have these seminar courses. We meet once per week. We teach them how to write a CV, a resume, you know, for industrial purposes, how you do presentations, you know, and especially also the importance of communication, because that's also something that industry values a lot. So those seminar courses, in that sense, have played a very useful role to at least give our students a little bit that other dimension that usually we cannot always easily accommodate in the courses. Okay.
Yeah, I see. Yeah, indeed. Yeah. I think, Joseph, you have a question, right?
Yeah. Well, first of all, Professor Grossmann, thank you very much for your amazing presentation.
Well, thank you.
It was really nice to hear from you or your experience in chemical engineering. I have a lot of questions, but I know that I don't have enough time to do them. Right. Let's focus on some that I think it will be more interesting for me and for all others that are listening to us. So right. There is something that I'm very curious about. You said that at least at some point of your product process design course, you right. have a retired engineer working with the students.
Right.
This is not working anymore, or do you still keep this relation with it?
Yeah. Let me explain to be more precise. So, this in our course, for example, I do involve somebody like Professor Jeff Cirola. He actually worked 35 years in Eastman Chemical, so he gives the lecture on the implications of shale gas. He gives a lecture on electron process synthesis because he wrote a book on that, and he gives a lecture on process safety, because I think especially the area of process safety is a very good one where engineers or retired engineers can do a much better job than we do, because safety is one of those things that it's not so easily, you cannot find so easily in a textbook, okay?
Yeah.
So we do involve by all means. And we have also in the past, for example, since we have here something called National Energy Technology Lab, have some of their engineers teach sometimes courses related to Aspen and how they use them. So I think it's very important to by all means include them, okay? Now, what I was referring, however, is the fact that I would say a good number of universities here in the United States, not many professors want to teach a course on process design. And what they do then instead, I'm not going to name the universities, but what they do instead, they say, well, you know what, since nobody wants to teach process design, how about if we have this person who worked in the industry and let him teach the entire thing? Because the rest of the professors, they don't want to know anything about the course. I don't find that's a good thing. That's not healthy, because I think
it
sends a message to the students that, first of all, this is not so important. And at the end, it is actually quite important. But the other one is also, I had a very interesting situation. This was quite a few years ago. John Anderson, he's now the president of the National Academy of Engineering. And he was in my department, and he was at one point department head. And then, you know, his area is colloids, polymers and surfaces, fluid mechanics, you know, that type of thing. But he had the courage one semester of saying, you know what, I would really like to teach part of the design course, because I'd like to learn how you do this. And, you know, so if we had a little bit more of the other professors also participating in the course, I think it would really help a lot. But that's what I meant to, I would first like to say that at least here in the U.S., many universities are saying, well, since nobody wants to teach process design, let's go and hire somebody from industry. They're retired, so we're also, you know, the condition is just simply what they call a teaching faculty, teaching professor, and then, you know, let them do the design, and we're, you know, don't have anything to do with it. That's what's happening here, and I don't think that's healthy. Yeah.
But in that case, does this teacher defines the project, or the students are allowed to choose anyone that they want to work with?
Oh, yeah. So let me say, that's one good point that you raised. So when we teach design, if I look at various universities, we tend to do it differently. So, for example, Professor Warren Cedar, University of Pennsylvania, he's the one who wrote that recent book on product and process design. What they do in their course is that each group gets assigned a different project, okay? A different project. In my course, I pick only one project. You know, it's only one problem. But now, why do I do this? Well, first of all, if I had to give to each group a different project, I would not be able to do any research. I wouldn't be able to do much of anything else. But more importantly, one of the things that we've done in the design course is the following. I don't want my students to spend a lot of the time developing for the design course a reactor model, because then the course becomes, how do you model a reactor? I want them to have the bigger picture and say, no, we want all these alternatives. So usually what I do in my course, when we pick a problem or a project, we say we're going to have some of my teaching assistants develop some of these computer tools that students can use. They already did the course in reaction engineering, so they know how to do that. But I don't want them to now develop from scratch a model, because then the scope of the project gets lost. Okay, so that's in that sense. We each do it differently. Okay, so some give a single project like I do. Some give a project to each group. Okay.
Okay. I don't know if we have a lot of questions from the audience, but may I ask one more?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay, just curious too. You have mentioned about the use of many software that from Excel and Aspen, GAMS. Right. But do you think, is it possible to achieve the same results only using free software?
Free software.
Because they are very expensive. So do you think it's possible?
Let me say the following. So, one thing I did not mention these days, what's become very fashionable, is of course Python-based type of software. And a good part of that is indeed open source software. Okay. Now, the only issue that I think it is important for students to get exposure to things like maybe Excel, Aspen, because that's what is used in industry. Okay. And the other thing that happens sometimes with open source software is that they keep changing a lot. So then that means what they learned here, well, it will no longer apply later. It's very good if you're doing more like research, then yes. But if it's for teaching, I would say, and actually you raise a good point, I'd be very happy to convey to that. I am part of something called an advisory board of Aspen Technology. They're trying to figure out how they can interact better with industries. I don't know, I'm curious. Do you use Aspen in your...
We use.
But do you have to pay for that, for example?
Yeah, we have.
As I told you, it's really very expensive. It's hard to renew the license.
Oh, wow. No, that's good feedback. I think the should realize that giving software to universities is like an investment. It's an investment for them for the future, because in that way, the students will learn about using Aspen when they go to industry. That's where they should be. They should not be charging. They should charge a very modest amount. I'd be more than happy.
There's one more thing which is quite interesting. In Brazil, I don't know if it's the same in the US, but ANSYS package, like Fluent and CFX, the students can get for free. There's a limitation on the number of computational cells you can use, but there's a lot of things you can accomplish. So that's a good thing.
Yeah.
And as far as I can tell, Aspen, we do pay, but we don't pay a lot. When we compare with the other license, it seems not to be very expensive, but we still have to pay.
I see, to give you an idea, GAMS, for example, since we do only small-scale problems, you can download it for free. You don't need to pay anything. It's only when you do you know, beyond maybe, you know, 100 or 200 variable type of problems that you do need the version of the license. But for teaching, I mean, we don't need those versions at all. So actually, at least I don't think, at least licenses in that sense has been a major issue with us. But I'll check on Aspen because that's an important one. Yeah, I it was brought to my attention recently. I don't know if I can maybe get hold of it. There's actually in Brazil, it's somebody who's actually doing some interesting software. Let me see if I can.
It's Enzo.
Emson,
that was developed from one of our colleagues in the Federal University of Rio.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
He's currently there. Before he was in the south of the country. We do use here in the Unicamp. We have it installed in our computers.
Right,
and,
right.
At least when I was teaching a particular subject, I used to do the same modeling in Aspen. In EMSO.
I see.
Yeah, the good thing about EMSO is that you can have access to the coding, not exactly the code, but to the modeling itself.
Yeah,
so
right.
You can
right,
change
right.
things, so it's very useful, very, very useful.
Right, right, right. Yeah, yeah. I was very surprised when I found out about it. Well, this looks like a nice tool. Yeah.
One of the things that we're doing here, we have a very, a simple software, a fluid mechanics software, a CFD code, which solves only the Euler equation. So we built a graphic interface.
Yeah,
it is on the computer lab as well. So when we are teaching fluid mechanics, for example, we can use that particular code that was developed by us to show the students what a streamline is, what a vector is, what happened to the fluid flow when the area is reduced, and simple things. I realized that when the students, they can see what we are teaching in the classroom, things get much easier.
Exactly. That's why I think it's very important to have visualization and things like that, because then they get also the kind of more feel of...
And the motivation as well.
Okay.
I have one question here, actually, that comes from the head of undergrad program, chemical engineering undergrad program. At the moment, Ignacio, we are going through, we're starting to review our chemical engineering course program.
Right, right.
Overall modification. So his question is, in your opinion, a multi-interdisciplinary approach of the curriculum of contents is the way that we should go, or we should stick more with the basic, the fundamental modules of the chem-eng course?
Yeah, I mean, I would say ideally we would like to have both. Okay, on the one hand, as I indicated, it's been always for me very interesting when we have industrial advisory boards. They always tell us, please make sure you keep the fundamentals, because the thing is this: in the business and the company, things can change. You know, maybe there's this area of emphasis, and it changes to something else. If things have a good basis, they can adapt to change. Okay, maybe if they have that basis. So that's a good thing. Now, having said that, it's of course also good if they can also have a little bit of a relationship with multidisciplinary type of approaches. The way we've approached that is the following. So in our curriculum, we have four elective courses that students can take. Okay, and those four courses are often combinations of minors. This minor, a very popular one is biomedical engineering. We have actually, by the way, a minor in supply chain. So some people take then courses in the business school. What's interesting, some of those minors, some students actually take minors in music or drama. So it's totally open. So we give them a choice of four courses where they can really explore whatever they want. So I think that's healthy, right? Because I think it's a good thing if they can, and if they have that interest, by all means, I think it's a good thing. But having said that, again, I would think a balance is what we need. I mean, if we go totally multidisciplinary, we may lose the identity. There could be that danger. I don't think that's a good thing. Now, we have another problem, well, another issue here, I call it a problem. I don't know if you have it in Campinas or in Brazil in general. In my department or at Carnegie Mellon, every semester, students take typically five courses. Out of those five, one has to be non-quantitative, non-analytical. Has to be a humanities type of course. Now, in principle, it's not a bad idea, but it does mean that, 20% of the time of our students, we cannot, for example, up in, I'm going to convey something that you may find a little surprising, but nevertheless, the design course takes a lot of time, right? So I've been actually the dean several years ago created a special list of those professors who made the students work too hard. Okay? And I was classified a flat two professor. Our students work too much. And I say, well, then I would like to give them more credits, okay? Because if they work more, they deserve more credit. I cannot do it because we have this other constraint. So then what do I do? And I say, well, I'm sorry, I'm going to continue teaching the same because I want to make sure that my students learn. That's my job. That's my obligation. I'm not going to, now remove material just to satisfy some administrators. But I don't know if you have those problems in Brazil, but we have them really quite a bit now.
One of the things that I like to mention to my students, just coming back a little bit on the fundamentals, is that we need to go to Mars. And then when I say that, they look at me, they frown in their heads and say, go to Mars? I say, yes, you need to go to Mars. And you never done that before, which means that you need to design a water treatment or something like that in Mars. And then if you don't know the fundamentals, you're not going to design anything.
Right.
It's just a tiny example, right? There's lots of other examples in Earth itself that needs to be developed that we never done before.
The only way
you can accomplish is if you have a very solid background.
Exactly.
That's the way you need to go. Well, let me see if I have more questions. José, I think you want to drop another question.
No, I'm just curious about this course. I think that we can learn a lot from you, because we have all this stuff that you have presented. We have the problems, especially, for example, when you said that the first time you asked for different projects, you went crazy about supervising all the students. So this happened to us here too sometime. Right. And then we decided for only one project. But I would like to know if you have some specific characteristics that you define for the project. So when you decide from one different semester to another, what are the specifications that you take care to keep?
One thing that I have found is very good is to make or work on what I would call projects that are relevant. So, for example, when I started to teach last time, this was over 10 years ago, biofuels was a big thing. And there was a lot of talk about biomass and so forth. And students get excited because they say, well, yes, this is like a new frontier. Then what happened is then this whole thing started with shale gas. And, so how do you build chemicals from methane and ethane, C1, C2 chemistry type of problems? And again, what was nice is that, it was industry that was telling us that that's important. Now, we did a very special project last semester, which was very unique. It was, what the project was? It was actually the idea of my colleague again, Jeff Cirola, direct capture of CO2 from air. I don't know if you're familiar with that problem. So the idea is to say, how do you capture CO2 from air? That's a project that we gave to them. I have to admit, it was very challenging, first of all, because it was not the typical type of process where you have reactors, separators, and so forth. I mean, it is, you know, what you have is basically fans that have to suck in the air. Then you still have, of course, separations taking place and so forth. But it was not easy. I was very lucky to have a very good teaching assistant. It was not easy to adapt some of the modules in Aspen to be able to do some of those calculations. And it was very challenging because there's now, on the one hand, there's a company in Switzerland called Climeworks, where they've actually commercialized CO2 capture from air, okay? They're quoting maybe something of the order of $200, $250 per ton of CO2. Okay, that's what they're quoting. And then here in the U.S., there's also some people at Harvard, where Professor David Keith, for example, also put together a company. And what's interesting, ExxonMobil, for example, has bought one of these CO2 capture. There was a very interesting article in The Economist some time ago where they were speculating how the world will look like in 2050. And you know what was the title of one of the articles? It was Big Oil Becomes Big Suck. You know, they were saying before the oil companies were in the business of extracting oil from the ground, now in the future they're going to be in the business of sucking CO2 out from air. And it was a very, students were very motivated with that project, but I can tell you it was super challenging because the economics were really bad in the sense that it was not easy to make some economically viable. But I think as long as I think these days, that's what I was also mentioning, like energy, sustainability. I mean, that's, you know, students hear that all the time. And if we can somehow include that in our course, especially the design project, is very conducive for doing that type of work, right? I mean, yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
I have one final question here.
Yeah.
It comes from Professor Anna Filetti. She is a colleague from our department, from my department, and from José Vicente as well. She's asking that, I mean, she's stating that chemical processes are by nature deterministic ones. So right. She wants to know, in your opinion, AI, artificial intelligence, will play an important role for this process in the future, and if so, how?
Yeah, so I mean, I would say there's no question there's been a lot of developments in AI, machine learning, and so forth. But the one thing, again, that's where if you really look and say, well, what's really behind this? Well, what are the fundamentals behind it? Well, then you start to realize, number one, statistics, for example. The statistics is a lot behind, you know, what people do in machine learning. I actually had a friend who sent me a cartoon where it said, you know, 10 years ago, it was called statistics. 20 years later, 10 years later, it was called now machine learning. They took out the statistics, it replaced machine learning. No, so I don't mean to be bad here, but I think what I'm trying to say, I think it's important that we, of course, by all means, that's why, for example, the course I described of numerical methods, it is important that we expose the students to machine learning and some of these ideas, but then also that they should realize that at the end, it's still very much, you know, basic math, like regression. I mean, that's used a lot. Neural networks are really nothing else but a very sophisticated way of doing regression and so forth. But to the specific question that was asked to me, I would say, yes, definitely, it will be becoming increasing roles. So it's important that our students understand, but they also understand the limitations, because that's the other big thing. Or it's not that machine learning or AI all of a sudden are going to solve all of our problems. Now, there are places where it can play a great role. Maintenance, for example, gathering a lot of data for predicting failures of equipment. Now, I think that's a great application, for example, and things of that sort. But you will never replace again. Professor Venkat Subramanian from Columbia University, I don't know if you know him, he's one of the leaders in AI, and that's what he says. He says, look, I mean, in chemical engineering, we still need to combine Yes, there's big data, but there are problems for it. There's also not big data. If you do experiments, there's only a limited number of data that you have. So you still need to understand what is the basic kinetics, the transport phenomena, type of things that are taking place. Because otherwise, if you take a totally black box type of approach, you're throwing away all the knowledge. And the idea would be, if anything, come up with hybrid type of systems where you can combine them.
Yeah, exactly. At the end of the day, it all comes down to the fundamentals again. I mean,
yeah, exactly.
The tool, yeah. That was really good, really, really nice to have you on board with us. We're very happy that you have accepted our invitation. Probably we would stay here the whole afternoon chatting with you. There's a lot of things. It was really pleasant.
Even days, maybe.
Yeah.
Even days. Not only this afternoon.
Who knows? Maybe in the future you want to come over and spend 1 year with us. That would be a wonderful experience, I can assure. But and again, on behalf of the...
By the way, let me just say one thing, because it's important that I tell you this. I've had so far in my career three students from Brazil. Jose Pinto, Bruno Calfa, Cristiana Lara. They have been all outstanding, which to me tells me that you're doing a really great job, no, seriously, in Brazil in chemical engineering education, because these were absolutely top-notch students. So we're very, very happy with them. So I think you're doing something right, something that we're even better than we are doing here in the States, okay?
Yeah.
So that you get that message. Okay.
Yeah, well. Yeah, thank you for that. Thank you for the compliment on behalf of my patrons, if I may say.
Yeah.
On behalf of the graduate program, I would like to thank you very much. And who knows, maybe in the future we will have an opportunity at least to you to spend some time here with us. That would be a lovely. I guess this is it. Yeah, thank you. Thank you
very much. You're welcome. Okay. It was very nice meeting you. All the best, and my regards to yourselves.
Thank you, Professor.
See you then. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Let me see, how do I disconnect from here?